seated. Come to order.
Okay. We're back. This is the case of Michael J. Daugherty, contestant, versus Fulton County Registration and Election Board, DeKalb County Registration and Election Board, Coffee County Board of Registration and Elections, Georgia State Election Board, Brad Raffensperger, in his official capacity as Secretary of State, Raphael G. Warnock, and Thomas Jonathan Ossoff, defendants. It's civil action number 2021 CB 344953, and that's a Fulton County case. All right, are we ready to proceed? We're here today for all pending motions, and we're here. There are numerous motions to dismiss. I have a total of at least 10 motions on my list. I think where we need to begin is with the verified applications for pro hoc vici motion.
Yes, Your Honor. Adam Sparks for Senator Warnock and Senator Ossoff.
Okay.
With me is Ms. Amanda Pillay, one of the three applicants for admission to pro hoc vici.
All right.
I'm happy to present her or address the applications at Your Honor's.
Either way.
Yes. Where would you like me to speak, Your Honor?
Whatever you are.
Right there at the corner is fine with me at this table.
Yes.
Okay. I can see you just fine. So you can see me, can't you?
Yes. May I move the microphone? Good afternoon, Your Honor. May it please the court. As I said, Adam Sparks for Senator Warnock and Senator Ossoff. I'm authorized to state that Senator Ossoff wishes for the applicants to represent him as well. The original applications were served on behalf of Senator Warnock, as he was the only one of the two senators who had appeared at that time. So with me today is Ms. Amanda Clay of Perkins Coie LLP. She flew in to be here today. The Senate defendants would prefer for Ms. Clay to deliver argument on the pending motions. If she is admitted in response to any other motion, that it advances their interest to speak upon. So all the applications have been filed with the court, Ms. Calais, Mr. Geis, and Mr. Newkirk. They were sent along with the requisite payment to the Georgia Bar. The Bar provided the letters stating the applications complied with Rule 4.4 and Appendix A. The Bar sent those letters to the court. We sent the letters upon counsel. We then, thereafter, received petitioner's objections to the three applications for admission. I should note that all three attorneys have been admitted pro hoc vici in several proceedings in Georgia, both state and federal court, over the past 2 years. All were included on their applications. They're all in good standing in their jurisdictions, where they are barred. None of them subject to bar proceedings, court discipline, anything of the like. They all have specialties and extensive experience in election law, which this case is a part. None more so than Ms. Clay, with whom I've worked for several years, and I can assure you she is of the highest caliber and the highest character, and is more than fit to practice pro hoc vici in this court. They're familiar with our client's needs, desires, arguments, filings, and most importantly, our client's desire that she represent them and speak for them here today. And ordinarily, that would be the end of the matter. Given petitioner's objections, I'll address them briefly, although they are addressed comprehensively in brief. Yes, sir.
I think we should give them an opportunity to object in the way that they see fit once you're through with sort of the basics of your application.
Yes, Your Honor, that's fine. I'm through the basics of the application. I'm happy to address anything else after this.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Hardwick. Yes, sir. We filed a consolidated response to all three of the applications, and then we filed a response to their reply. As far as the grounds, we think there's a few. Of course, the court knows this is discretionary upon the court under Uniform Rule 4.4. Some of our concerns are this law firm represented in the New York case basically our claims that Dominion voting machines didn't properly calculate votes, and now they're taking an opposite position to that in this case. So we think it creates a positional conflict in that regard and may make some of their attorneys witnesses in this case if they have evidence that would show that. Additionally, there's been some letters which we've attached. All these are attached as exhibits to our responses, where they've sent letters trying to, we would say, hamper or threaten, slow down the Arizona ballot inspection or audit, whatever you'd like to call it. Also, the law firm itself was sanctioned by the Fifth U.S. Court of Appeals for some Texas cases that were going on as part of election litigation. It's my understanding that the Fifth Circuit has now released some of the lower associates from those sanctions, but have upheld them against the upper tier attorneys and partners. With regard to that discretion, we also contend that they're abusing the pro hac vici privilege, Your Honor. It's a privilege, and the court gets to decide that. I think Ms. Kelly herself, this would be her 16th appearance in a Georgia court pro hac vici. Seems a bit excessive. I think some of the other applicants had two or three prior pro hac admissions. Those are our primary concerns, Your Honor, and we've outlined it in our response and our reply, but I'm sure you've seen that. We've attached the documentation. That's just kind of the key points that we're looking at this point, and we would ask you to deny that, and we think Mr. Sparks is more than capable of representing these clients without attorneys outside of our jurisdiction, Your Honor.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Your Honor, a couple of points about that. While I'm appreciative of counsel's confidence in me, I owe a larger duty to my clients who have their own wishes if they wish to speak here and represent themselves today, and that duty takes precedence. In terms of the rule, counsel's correct. This is a discretionary decision within Your Honor's discretion under Rule 4.4. You're allowed to admit attorneys to appear in a particular proceeding. Ordinarily, they should be granted per 4.4, Section D, Subsection 3. To address the abuse of privilege point for a moment, I would contend that's wrong for a number of reasons, the most important of which may be that all of the cases in which Ms. Calais has applied to appear pro hoc vici, and she's been either admitted or the case has ended and been mooted before the bar had a chance to provide the requisite letter, all of them have to do with election law. Nine of them actually dealt with defending challenges to 2020 election procedures and results. Many of those are based in the settlement agreement of a case that Ms. Calais litigated, settled, and eventually filed a settlement agreement between November 2019 and March 2020. There are very few people on the planet that would have been more familiar with and more capable of litigating cases involving that settlement agreement than Ms. Calais. All of these cases were defensive in nature, if I recall correctly, and none of the cases remained pending. We actually looked into whether there was case law on whether this conduct constituted the frequent practice of law per, I think it's 4.4D3D. I think I have that right. There's very little case law out there. What there is, cited in our brief, and it supports our point of view, where you had an attorney who was out of state and had applied for 10 pending cases, all going on at the same time, pro hoc vici, and the court said, well, this attorney has a particular specialty. It's within a narrow area of law. And so what the client prefers, and so we're going to grant the application pro hoc vici, and that fits with other more anecdotal evidence that I've been able to cobble together. So, I would submit that the abuse of privilege point is simply incorrect on the law, and Your Honor should exercise his discretion to admit Ms. Calais. Now, as to more specific points having to do with the firm of Perkins Coie, not Ms. Calais, other attorneys in other cases, in other states, and other matters, I would ask Your Honor's lenience to let Ms. Calais address any specific concerns Your Honor has, simply because I am familiar with and love the firm I am a part of, but it is not Perkins Coie LLP, so it may be a bit out of line for me to rebut those directly, aside from what we've already submitted in our written pleadings. How would Your Honor want us to proceed?
I think I've heard enough. I've read the briefing.
Yes, Your Honor.
And I'm going to go ahead and grant the application to allow her to be admitted to provoke each.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Let's move now to the substance of the motions. It seems to me that it makes sense to start with Senator Warnock's motion to dismiss. Does anyone have an objection to us beginning there?
No, Your Honor.
No, Your Honor.
Oh.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just one moment,
so.
Your Honor, Amanda Play on behalf of Senators Warnock and Ossoff. Senator Ossoff filed a motion to dismiss last week that joined the Senator Warnock's motion.
Was that filed?
It was filed Friday afternoon.
Yes. Has it been filed stamped?
Your Honor, I can address that, Mr. Sparks. We filed it on Friday evening, just after 6 p.m. We've been seeking a file stamped copy and have been on the phone with Fulton Court all day. They have not provided us with one yet, which is why I submitted the courtesy copies Friday evening.
All right. And you've seen them?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So through no fault of theirs, this has not been file stamped?
Correct, Your Honor. They're just waiting for the clerk to accept it and send out an email.
Well, let's go ahead and consider both of them at the same time.
Yes, sir.
I think for Your Honor's benefit, Senator Ossoff's motion simply adopts the arguments that were made in Senator Warnock's and makes one additional argument that just expands upon our improper service arguments that are made in Senator Warnock's. The Georgia Supreme Court has made clear repeatedly that election contests should be heard expeditiously to avoid uncertainty, confusion, and prejudice, and to ensure the smooth operation of government. Where an election contest is not filed swiftly, where defendants are not diligently and promptly served, and where contests linger for months, they are consistently dismissed. This election contest is a classic example of delay, and the resulting infirmities from that delay provide the court with several reasons to dismiss the lawsuit. And I'll just go over this contest, and I'll go through each of those in turn. First, as we have discussed, and the state in particular has discussed in its brief, its motion to dismiss, Mr. Daugherty filed this contest after Senators Warnock and Ossoff were sworn in and seated to the U.S. Senate. Article 1, Section 5, Clause 1 of the U.S. Constitution says that at this point, only the U.S. Senate can judge the senators' qualifications and elections, and that strips this court of jurisdiction to hear this matter at all. Second, Mr. Daugherty inexplicably delayed serving both Senators Warnock and Ossoff properly until just last week on July 12th. That's nearly 6 months after this contest was filed. The Georgia Supreme Court made clear in Swain v. Thompson that such delayed service in an election contest is improper, and it bars this court from exercising its jurisdiction here as well. Third, Mr. Daugherty's claims all rely on the November 3rd, 2020 general election, despite the fact that this is couched as a contest attacking the Senate election. The petition itself details, the exhibits supporting the petition and the petition itself all detail problems with the November 3rd, 2020 general election. As a result, this case could have and should have been brought after the November 3rd general election and well before the January 5th Senate runoff election took place. The result is that this case is also barred by the equitable doctrine of laches. Finally, in addition to the several jurisdictional bars to this case, Mr. Daugherty's petition fails to state a claim under Georgia's election contest statute. This provides another independent ground for dismissal and makes clear that this case is not the type of case that the court should entertain what the Georgia Supreme Court has called the drastic remedy of overturning an election, especially in the months after the candidates in that election have been sworn in, seated, and represented voters and and individuals in Georgia in the U.S. Senate. So, Your Honor, I'll briefly address each of these grounds for dismissal. I'm happy to go through them, but if you have any questions, I'm also happy to answer those directly.
Okay. So. Please proceed.
First, Your Honor, because this contest was filed on January 25th, 5 days after Senators Warnock and Ossoff were sworn in and seated as U.S. Senators without any objections or caveats by that swearing in, this court does not have jurisdiction to hear this contest. The language in the U.S. Constitution is unequivocal. Article 1, Section 5, Clause 1 of the Constitution states that each house shall be the judge of the elections, returns, and qualifications of its own members.
Is it your position that the lack of reservation language at the time that they were sworn in is important?
Certainly, Your Honor, there had been reservation language. For example, the court in Roadbush v. Harkey talks about the fact that in that contest there was a reservation language that specifically the Senate swore that specifically the members in that case were sworn in based upon the results of the contest.
That's 1970 case of Indiana.
Yes.
Correct.
So that's it. Yes. Yes, Your Honor. So that's particular language, and it in and of itself conditions the swearing-in upon the results of a separate contest or a separate state recount, actually.
Is there language such as that exists in this case with respect to either of our two United States Senators?
No, Your Honor. They were sworn in without any conditions at all. And what we know is that based upon the language in Roadbush v. Harkey, also Reed v. County Commissioners of Delaware County, what we know is that when Senators are sworn in, it then becomes the exclusive jurisdiction of the U.S. Senate to judge the elections and qualifications of their members. So at that point, once one Senator Warnock and one Senator Ossoff were sworn in, there was nothing that this court or any court in Georgia or even a federal court could do. This now lies within the jurisdiction of the U.S. Senate. So this acts as a jurisdictional bar. The only argument that Mr. Daugherty has made in response is simply that under Georgia law, they have 5 days to file an election contest. And while that may be true, in this case, they needed to act sooner. And the reason they needed to act sooner is because once the senators were sworn in, this court has no jurisdiction. And the U.S. Constitution is the supreme law of the land, as the Georgia Supreme Court has affirmed. And so at this point, that's what controls this case.
In the 1970 case out of it's Indiana. It's the Harkey case.
Yes, Your Honor.
What did they say about the recount and whether or not the state could proceed with the recount? I believe that was a very small margin of victory.
Yes, Your Honor. It was a very small margin of victory in that case. And in that case, the question was different because there was not a question of mootness that was present. Because the Senate itself, while it had provisionally sat the member, there was still a caveat based upon the fact that there was a pending recount to take place. So the recount did not move the action. But here, we're just not dealing with that situation. We're dealing with the situation in which mootness has occurred because the senators have been seated, they have been sworn in, and this court can't issue any relief. The relief that's asked for in this contest is that the election be repealed, that the results be overturned, that the results be reexamined. But that's not something that this court can issue because the U.S. Senate is the only body that has jurisdiction to judge the qualifications at this point.
If there was another election and that matter was then sent to the Senate for their consideration, then would they have the authority then to review those new results and make a different determination?
Well, frankly, Your Honor, at this point, this court doesn't have jurisdiction to order another election for the senators. The election of Senators Warnock and Ossoff can only be judged by the U.S. Senate. They have the exclusive purview at this point to determine the results of those elections and their qualifications. So if the court were I would argue this court couldn't order another election in this for these particular Senate seats because it's not within this court's jurisdiction.
So the state's deprived of the opportunity at this point to have another election because the Senate now controls their membership.
At this point, the state cannot hold another election for Senators Warnock and Ossoff. You can't re-hold the January 5th, 2021 Senate runoff because that election has already occurred, it's been certified, and the senators have been sworn in. So now, if there are questions about their qualifications, questions about their election, the U.S. Senate has the jurisdiction to hold that. Now, had the contest...
So it cuts off any kind of election contest that's filed from the date that they're sworn in going forward. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, Your Honor. From the date that they were sworn in and the Senate sat them, the Senate obtained exclusive jurisdiction over determining their election qualifications.
And the state no longer has any right to impact that.
Not based on the relief that's requested here, Your Honor. This request to sort of undo the election and rehold an election. The state can't do that at this point.
Okay. Please continue.
Your Honor, I'll talk a little bit at this point about service. The Georgia Supreme Court has made clear that where proper service has not been effectuated, the court does not have jurisdiction to hear a case. In an election contest, proper service depends upon two things. First, pursuant to the Georgia Code, Section 212.524F, proper service is personal service effectuated upon the defendant in that case by a sheriff. And then there's also a timeliness aspect, which this court lays out in Swain v. Thompson. In Swain v. Thompson, the Supreme Court clarified that the burden of timely service is on the plaintiff, and the plaintiff must show that they have diligently acted to properly effectuate service. And in the event that at any point in the process, the plaintiff is put on notice that that service was improper, they then are subjected to a higher standard, and they must show, I think it's to the greatest possible diligence, that they have attempted to effect proper service. This is for good reason. In an election contest, because it's important to minimize prejudice and to ensure confidence in the elections, these need to move fast. And so requiring quick and expedient service in these contests is important. It's something that the Supreme Court has noted the legislature had as the underlying intent to set out the service rules. Here, the record does not reflect diligent service, nor does it reflect service that occurred under the greatest possible diligence.
They've attempted two different types of service in this case, isn't that true?
Yes, sir.
And you're claiming that one of the ways in which they've attempted service is defective?
Yes, sir.
And that's because it doesn't comply with the clear statutory language that requires service be by the sheriff.
Yes, Your Honor. Personal service effectuated by the sheriff.
Personal service effectuated by the sheriff.
Yes, Your Honor.
What did they do instead?
So instead what the record reflects in their affidavits is that on February 13th, they attempted to serve Senator Ossoff and Senator Warnock in Washington, D.C. via process server. They were unable to do that.
What day?
I believe it's February 13th.
February 13th.
February 13th, so that's a little over 2 weeks after the contest was filed, an additional 5 days, so 3 weeks after the senators were seated.
By process server.
So that service attempt, even if it had been successful, which it was not, would not have been proper because it did not comply with the Georgia Code. It was not proper service in Georgia upon defendants in an election contest. The next attempt at service was on Senator Warnock on March 30th, where a process server, not the sheriff, again attempted to serve someone at Senator Warnock's office in Atlanta. That service was not personal on Senator Warnock. In addition, the person that was served did not have authority to accept service on his behalf, and we've submitted affidavits in the record that reflect that.
Was that the sheriff, or was that a process server?
Process server, again.
Again, a process server. March 15th.
March 30th,
I'm sorry.
So.
One second.
And I'll also double
served ordinary process on aid to Senator Warnock on March the 15th at Senator's Plan of Office. This is page 10,
okay.
First paragraph.
My apologies, Your Honor.
I just want to know which it is. Is it the 30th or is it 15th?
My apologies, Your Honor. Service, the attempt was made on March 15th. The affidavit was submitted on March 30th.
Okay.
So the first attempt by the process server on both Senators Ossoff and Warnock was February 13th, several weeks after they were seated. The second attempt on Senator Warnock was on March 15th. That attempt at service was successful and that someone from Senator Warnock's office did receive notice of a lawsuit. And Senator Warnock was not proper, but it did occur. And because of that, Senator Warnock entered an appearance in this conditionally just to protect his position and argued that service was insufficient. That argument was made both in his answer to the petition and also in a motion to dismiss. So as of April 9th, Mr. Daugherty was on notice that the service that was effectuated upon Senator Warnock on March 15th and also the attempts that were made on February 13th did not comply with Georgia's contest statute.
What's the heightened standard?
So the heightened standard in Swain says that once someone is on notice, which would have occurred in this case on April 9th, the plaintiff must be able to show that they've acted with the greatest possible diligence to effectuate service.
And that's the language of the case.
Yes, Your Honor.
The greatest possible diligence.
The greatest possible diligence. The next attempt at service was made on July 12th, just a week ago. That's nearly 3 months after Senator Warnock's motion to dismiss was filed, which put plaintiff on notice that they were under a heightened standard and that service was improper. And no attempts, there's nothing in the record that indicates that any other attempts were made on Senator Warnock or Senator Ossoff. So we have a 3 month delay from April 9th until July 12th. Nothing in the 6 months that it took to effectuate service under the statutory requirements, and certainly in the 3 months that it took to effectuate service after plaintiff was put on notice that service was improper, indicates at the minimal standard of diligence, but certainly not the greatest possible diligence that's required in an election contest. These contests have to move fast, and there is good reason that a contestant should not be able to wait 6 months to serve a senator pursuant to the statute and the rules that the legislature has set out. Because of that, under Swain v. Thompson, service is still improper, it has not been timely, and this court again does not have jurisdiction to hear this contest, and it must be dismissed. Third, Your Honor, Mr. Daugherty's action is also barred by the equitable doctrine of latches. In Georgia, latches bars a claim where there's been a lapse of time and a claimant has neglected to assert his rights, and then there's prejudice to the adverse party. In this case, as I mentioned at the beginning, while this is styled as a contest to the January 5th, 2021 Senate election, all of the allegations in the petition and the supporting exhibits focus on the November 3rd general election and some incidents that occurred afterwards during the context of the statewide audit or the recount. All of those were known well before January 5th, and in fact, there were several lawsuits that were brought, both contests and lawsuits in federal court, that were based upon these same allegations right after the November 3rd election. In December leading up to the Senate election, there's just no reason that in this case, this contest needed to wait to be filed until January 25th, which is significantly after the election occurred, and many, many, many weeks after the actual allegations that the petition is based upon.
There's a continuation theory. that's brought by Contestant. Do you wish to address that now, or do you want to wait until after they have responded to your argument?
I'm happy to address it now, Your Honor, and I'll point in particular in this context to the state's brief, because the state addresses that, I think, quite thoroughly in their motion to dismiss. But the January 5th runoff election, when you look at the Georgia contest statute, it's simply not a continuation of the November 3rd election. These elections occur, the contest itself occurs per election, right? So if we have a problem with what occurs on November 3rd, there's a reason that we address it 5 days after those election results are certified. And the reason is because if it's going to impact the next election, in this case, the January 5th, 2021 Senate runoff, we want that to happen before the election takes place. It minimizes prejudice, it decreases confusion, and it provides a better process for Georgia citizens. For this reason, the January 5th, 2021 election isn't a continuation of the November 3rd. It's its own separate election, and it's dealt with as its own separate election in terms of the contest statute.
In other words, before 4 million people vote at a runoff election, you ought to be able to correct the problem arose at the November 3rd election.
Yes, Your Honor, and I actually think a very good example of this is if you look at there are several cases in Georgia that deal with primary and general elections. So if you look at Jordan v. Cook, for example, or Payne v. Chapman, one thing that's very clear in those contexts is that once the general election has occurred after a primary election, whole case is moot. And the reason is because problems in a primary election need to be dealt with before the general election occurs so that you don't have hundreds and thousands of Georgia voters voting in a general election where problems could easily be dealt with earlier. The same concept is applicable here. You don't want 4 million people voting on January 5th when those problems could have easily been addressed 5 days after the November 3rd election was certified. And we know that those problems could have been addressed because the allegations in the petition, for one, they all focus on, you know, date after date is in December of 2020, November of 2020. Repeatedly, these dates are coming up, and we're not seeing anything that occurred on January 5th or after January 5th in the factual allegations. But in this case, in particular, there were several cases that were actually brought, many of which were based on the same factual support that is included in this petition. So, for example, Exhibit 20, 21, 22, all of those exhibits to the petition were actually exhibits that were part of the would-be Raffensperger case that was brought in November, challenging the November 3rd election. There's no reason that Mr. Daugherty, if he had a concern, couldn't have joined that lawsuit, couldn't have brought his own contest here in Georgia. And in fact, under the doctrine of latches, he had a responsibility to do that. He neglected to do that. He sat on his rights, and the prejudice that had occurred is very clear. An election took place, over 4 million individuals in Georgia voted, 2 senators were sat, and they have been seated in the U.S. Senate, sworn in, and representing Georgians for over 6 months now. Hold a new election, to call all of that into question is extremely prejudicial, and it's precisely why the election contest statute makes it clear that you have to move quickly and that Mr. Daugherty should have moved quickly to address these problems before the January 5th runoff occurred. Finally, Your Honor, in addition to the many jurisdictional problems with this lawsuit, Mr. Daugherty's complaint also fails to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. Georgia Supreme Court requires that even at the pleading stage of an election contest, the plaintiff must plead enough facts in the contest to support an inference that fraud, misconduct, or irregularities occur such that they would impact the actual outcome of the election. Here, all the allegations of fraud, misconduct, irregularities, they relate to a different election. They do not relate to the January 5th Senate runoff. They relate to the November 3rd, 2020 general election. In fact, there are no facts supporting irregularities sufficient to impact the outcome of the January 5th Senate runoff in the record. I believe there's actually only one exhibit that deals with the Senate runoff itself, and it talks about an isolated delay in voting.
Columbia County.
In Columbia County. The exhibit itself is entitled, it makes it clear that this is, that it actually, the delay didn't impact the election itself. No one stopped voting. Voting continued. On page 9 of the petition, it says that the number of ballots that were adjudicated during the January 5th election is unknown. Based on these facts, they're just not sufficient facts in the record to support any inference that there were misconduct, irregularities, or any other problems in the January 5th election, which is what's necessary to even move forward from the complaint stage to get to a bona fide contest, to get to hearing on the merits. At this point, all of this is just speculation because there are no allegations that show that there were insufficiencies sufficient to impact the results of either Senator Warnock or Senator Ossoff's election. And Your Honor, if I may, I think the only thing that I'd like to leave the court with, unless you have other questions, is just that the Georgia Supreme Court has made very clear that setting aside an election in which people have chosen their representative is a drastic remedy. It should not be undertaken lightly, but instead should be reversed for cases in which a person challenging an election has clearly established a violation of election procedures and has demonstrated that the violation has placed the results of the election in doubt. The Supreme Court said that in 2019. There has not been any such
case. Is that the Martin case?
That is the Martin case.
Is there a, there was discovery that was allowed in the Martin case, isn't that true? As part of that election contest, wasn't Judge Grubbs the presiding judge in that case?
There was discovery allowed in that contest, Your Honor. But the facts of that contest were sufficient, were extremely different, and the jurisdictional problems that exist here did not exist for all of the defendants who were in the election contest, in that particular election contest. So you're dealing with really apples and oranges of an election contest. Those facts in particular focused on specific facts related to the lieutenant governor's election in 2018. Here, the plaintiff is challenging a Senate runoff election based upon facts that occurred in a different election in 2020.
At the pleading stage in the Martin case, was there a motion to dismiss based upon some sort of lack of failure to state a claim?
There was, I can't precisely reply, Your Honor, there was a motion to dismiss that was granted against the state, who was named as a defendant in that case, and the state is, as the court found, was not a proper defendant, and so therefore a motion to dismiss was granted against them. But I cannot recall if there were specific allegations of the lack.
I'm wondering to what degree there were specifics in that complaint that were addressed in a similar motion to dismiss. But I understand that's really into the weeds and in an older case, and I'm certainly not going to hold you to knowing the answer to that right this moment.
And I can certainly check when I sit back, Your Honor.
I didn't see it in the briefing. I mean, I should say in the opinion, but anyway.
But what I know, Your Honor, is that in this case, there has been no demonstration that this court, there's been no demonstration in this court that there's been a clearly established violation of election procedures. This is not the type of case that deserves the drastic remedy of reholding an election months after an election has taken place, after senators have been seated and sworn in. And this court should decline to entertain this contest or award that remedy to Mr. Daugherty and dismiss this case for lack of jurisdiction.
One more related question is, if the court lacks the jurisdiction to entertain this contest, or if for some other reason the court concludes, for instance, latches, that Senator Warnock and Senator Ossoff should be dismissed, what does that do to the remaining claims?
You mean the claims?
As to all of the other defendants. I should say, all of the other parties in the action. Is there any consequence to that? Are the remaining motions mooted?
Well, Your Honor, the court lacks jurisdiction to issue, particularly on the first grounds, the first jurisdictional grounds, the fact that this is really something that can only be heard by the U.S. Senate. The court lacks jurisdiction on those grounds. It simply cannot hear this case, and that would apply to all of the defendants. Latches would be the same bar, right? They failed to state a claim. That applies to all of the defendants in this case. So when we're talking about these jurisdictional grounds or these very fundamental points of the petition itself, that applies across the case.
I'll make it just even more simple. If Senator Warnock and Senator Ossoff are dismissed on the grounds that you have submitted to the court, then we're done.
Yes, Your Honor.
Is there anything else?
No, Your Honor, unless you have a question.
Well, the article of the Constitution is Article 1, but it's Section 4. It's time, place, and manner. And that's reserved to the states, Your Honor. And the state of Georgia has a right to legislate in regard to elections. That's how they're conducted, where they're conducted, and how you challenge results. So we're not talking about qualification, we're talking about the result. This action was actually filed January 24th. It wasn't accepted to the 25th because the 24th was a Sunday. So it was filed within the 5 days allowed by Georgia law. In regard to Swain, a careful reading of Swain isn't a basic statement that the greatest possible diligence is required in all election cases. What it said there was that the process that was actually served was insufficient because they did a 30-day summons versus the 10-day special process required under the elections contest statutes. And that once they were put on notice about that, then they had to exercise this greatest possible degree of diligence. Senator Ossoff has never filed any type of notice in this court. Other than his motion to dismiss and answer, he just filed on, I believe it was Friday.
When was he served?
The certification was January, January 19th was when it was certified.
By the sheriff.
Oh, you're talking about service? I believe that was filed the following Monday.
The Swain versus Thompson case is a service case, correct?
Correct.
That's what we're talking about right now, service.
Yes, but Senator Ossoff was just served like last week and he filed his answer and motion to dismiss Friday, a few days after he was served. So there was no prior notice to accelerate to this greatest degree of due diligence that is mentioned in Swain because Senator Ossoff had never filed anything to put us on notice.
One second, please. You received a copy of Senator Warnock's motion to dismiss somewhere on or about April the 9th, 2021, correct?
Correct.
All right, and in there, did they not indicate to you that there was a failure to properly serve Senator Warnock?
They did. I'm talking about Senator Ossoff.
Are you counsel of record in both cases?
I'm counsel of record for the petitioner. Yes.
Right. So just in the one case, and so you would have received this and read this at or about April the 9th?
Yes.
Okay. Please continue.
Yes. With regard to the 12B6 argument, this is a continuation under Georgia law. 21-2-500-1, I believe it's A-10, states the runoff election shall be a continuation of the election for that particular office concerned. Of course, it has runoff, primary, and all these other types of contests in there, but for us, it's the runoff election. And That's 212501A10. In regard to the 12D6 issue, as the court's aware, the standard in Georgia is Walker County v. Tri-State Crematorium. It says dismissal is appropriate only where a complaint shows with certainty that the plaintiff would not be entitled to relief under any set of facts that could be proven in support of his claim. We've pled, and Georgia's a notice pleading claim, state, Your Honor, so we think there's sufficient notice in the complaint about what our claim is. If you look at some of the cases that are cited, you mentioned Martin. The Martin case, Your Honor, there was discovery done in that case, and they're actually appealing the granting of a 911-41B, an involuntary dismissal. So that's not the standard for a 12B6. That's the standard at trial. They said, hey, you didn't meet your burden at trial. It has nothing to do with the complaint. The complaint just has to put them on notice.
In that case, there was a complaint. There was discovery. There was a final trial. And then there was a dismissal after the presentation of evidence.
Yes, sir. That's my understanding, Your Honor. And also, Georgia law clearly says that 212524C, when an error in counting of votes is alleged as a ground of contest, it is sufficient for the contestant to state generally that he or she believes that error was committed in the counting of votes cast. And it shall not be necessary for the contestant to offer evidence to substantiate such allegation. If it's pled, it's pled. You don't need all this evidence. That's always the argument. Oh, there's no evidence of it. Well, we haven't even been through discovery yet, Your Honor. That's the purpose of discovery, is to flesh out these things. The purpose of a 12B6 is to get rid of a complaint that doesn't state a claim, that no relief could be granted. There's no provable set of facts. Well, there is a provable set of facts. They want to talk about the November election. The November election is the basis for the eligibility of who gets to run in the January 5th election. Runoff election, Your Honor. So if you're not eligible based upon the November election result, and it's a continuation, that eligibility is a question up until 5 days after certification.
Why didn't you challenge that after the November 3rd election?
I wouldn't retain at that point, Your Honor.
But isn't that the time to say that somebody's not qualified to proceed further?
Well, I think you could bring it in, but I don't think Georgia law requires it. I think Georgia law says eligibility for the runoff election can be challenged up till 5 days after certification.
Okay.
That's my understanding of the law, Your Honor.
Please continue. I don't want to interrupt you.
I'm just making sure I covered it.
Sure. I want to be sure that I've heard everything that you have to say about the latches argument.
Well, I don't think it's a latches argument, Your Honor. That's the relinquishment of a known right. He didn't relinquish any right. He filed it within the statutory time period. Tried to serve them at their house. We couldn't serve them there. We tried to serve them in D.C. We couldn't serve them there. Finally, the sheriff was actually able to get Senator Ossoff, like I said, last week, last Monday, I believe it was. So I don't think he's relinquished a known right. I think he's proceeded by filing timely, and he's tried to effectuate service. I'll be honest with you, I still have service pending in the sheriff's office for Senator Warnock, which apparently they said they tried to serve him July 12th, but I haven't seen a return of service or a non-est on it. I don't think we've relinquished a known right or committed latches.
And Senator Ossoff accepted service through his attorney.
Yes, sir.
Last week.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Okay. Closing on your motion.
Need not be alleged more than generally. The facts themselves that lead to that inference, typical of any sort of notice pleading in a state, those facts do need to be alleged. At this point, what we have is a petition that alleges facts that indicate that the petitioner believes that there were problems in the November 3rd, 2020 election, not a petition that indicates that there were problems in the January 5th, 2021 Senate runoff election. There's just simply not enough to put anyone on notice about what problems, if any, petitioner believes occurred on January 5th with the count, with the regularities, with misconduct. And so for that reason, if we're looking at LSP Johnson, the court has said that in a contest, you have to allege facts that support the inference, even if you can generally state the ultimate conclusion that there was conduct or regularities.
Okay.
I'm sorry
about
that, Your Honor.
Nothing else. All right. The court finds that Senator Warnock and Senator Ossoff have not been properly served. There has not been the due diligence that would be expected under these circumstances in the election contest. Further, the court finds that this matter is barred by the equitable doctrine of laches. This action has not been diligently pursued, and particularly in the area of service of process. The case is dismissed, and I've asked Ms. Kalei to please prepare the proposed order. Thank you. We're adjourned.